Professional wrestling is an incredibly unique form of entertainment, and nowadays, it's generally perceived as a mix of drama and athletic choreography. But in simple terms, it's simulated fighting. And on the surface, if aliens were to come down and look at what professional wrestling is, they'd likely consider it to be the sign of an advanced culture. What? Advanced? Yes. As silly as wrestling may seem at times, it could be argued, theoretically, that this is the performance of an intelligent species. Think about it. Modern human beings have ingrained in them a curiosity about violence and conflict. And this is why people watch boxing, MMA, and UFC. It's also why they watch schoolyard fights and crashes and explosions and nature videos where some lion is eating a deer or some bear is eating a salmon. Oh yeah, the bear eats a salmon episode. That's the good one. Now, whether you agree with the philosophy of Thomas Hobbes, who says we are fascinated by violence because we are inherently evil, or you agree with the ideas of Jean-Jacques Rousseau, the philosopher who believed that we're not inherently evil, it's just that society corrupts us, which would explain why we're curious about violence, the fact remains the same. Both philosophies seem to agree. At the end, we end up evil. Oh great, spoiler alert. Now, whether it's gratuitous violence, like you'd see in a Die Hard film, or restrained violence, like you'd see in 50 Shades of Grey, or verbal violence, like you'd see with an insult comic, we tend to find entertainment in violence. But our society also frowns upon violence. Most cultures aim to be peaceful and harmonious. Harmony is the human ideal, according to most philosophies and ideologies and religions. So, we kind of like violence, but we kinda don't want it to be a thing. And from that perspective, pro wrestling seems like a pretty advanced form of entertainment. Simulated fighting. It acknowledges that we're interested in violence, one-on-one competition, we're interested in combat, but we also know it's not a good thing. So, pro wrestling seeks to satiate that curiosity in a controlled setting. The audience gets its fix for violence, nobody gets hurt. And sure, some purists and some enthusiasts would argue that wrestling does not satiate people the same way that boxing or MMA do. But it does for some, and it can do so without hurting people, which on paper seems like a pretty evolved form of entertainment. Moving away from violence has been one of the hallmarks of human progression for centuries. That's why we don't have gladiator versus lion fights anymore. So, in some ways, wrestling is very meta. We like violence, we know we shouldn't have it though, so let's just pretend to do it and enjoy that. It's like tofurkey. Now, vegetarians may like eating birds. I don't know. But if they do eat a bird, they probably feel like they shouldn't. So they create a non-violent version of birds, made of tofu. And yes, some would say that tofurkey does not satiate the taste for meat the same way that normal turkey does, but it does for some. The point is, it's a creation designed to address a human trait, that some people do not support violence. Tofurkey addresses violence against animals, pro wrestling addresses violence against people. Now, that wasn't its intention, but still, that is what it does. So, the point of all this is to simply remember that pro wrestling is tofurkey. So, pro wrestling seems like an advanced civilization's entertainment, and yet, ironically, for much of its existence, say that wrestling fans are not intelligent. There are plenty of intelligent people who have been fans of professional wrestling. But the organizations that offer wrestling have traditionally geared themselves towards feeble-minded audiences because, although I could make an argument that it is an advanced form of entertainment for the evolved sports fan, pro wrestling never sought to be that. They never sought to be evolutionary. Pro wrestling was created because it sought to be dishonest. Yeah, early professional wrestling built its name on deception. In the early 1900s, there were plenty of these strongman competitors and shoot fighters that would compete at carnivals and fairs to make money in legitimate competitions. But one of the reasons pro wrestling became choreographed is because crowds would get bored watching two guys wrestle around on the ground forever. And that's not a knock against wrestling. Wrestling requires tremendous strength, cardio, and skill. And wrestlers are deceptively fit athletes. But if you think about it, traditional wrestling is basically two men playing a game of hold me down. That's the objective, for one human to hold down another human. And that is one of the reasons amateur wrestling is not big business. At least not in the way some of the more mainstream sports are. A casual viewer who doesn't know all the rules typically won't understand what they're looking at. It's not intuitive to the casual viewer who doesn't understand the scoring or the techniques of the sport. So to the average viewer, they're watching two people roll around on the ground. And the average person would likely consider that boring. And boring sports don't sell. At least, not as well as action-packed sports do. And that is why pro wrestling became a thing. There were more legitimate wrestling contests that took place in the early 20th century that involved guys like Frank Gotch and George Hackenschmidt. But the problem was, sometimes they lasted for hours, and sometimes they never even resulted in a victory. Imagine that, two grown men playing a game of hold-me-down for hours, and nobody even wins. To truly understand how dull that can be, from a modern perspective, check out the Royce Gracie versus Ken Shamrock fight from the early days of the UFC. It was at UFC 5. These two great fighters were locked in combat in what was billed as a super fight. But in actuality, they may as well have called it Gracie versus Shamrock. For over half an hour, these two guys, who are definitely awesome athletes, amazing fighters, but for half an hour, these guys were locked in the cuddle of doom, and it wasn't fun to watch. It didn't satiate any desire for athletic contests, and lots of people didn't even order the next pay-per-view. UFC 5 had 260,000 buys. UFC 6 had 240,000. That's 20,000 people that fell asleep during UFC 5. I mean, super fight, more like a slumber fight, if you know what I'm saying. And I think you do. UFC has since evolved to try to encourage more competitive matches by introducing rounds and time limits and by giving bonuses that encourage more competitive fighting. But that fight, Gracie versus Shamrock, is likely a decent representation of why original wrestling contests lost people's interest. Thus, pro wrestling began choreographing matches so that they could essentially better control the audience reaction and make more money. If people thought that the matches were too long, okay, let's make sure that they're short. If they don't like the fact that there's not a winner, let's make sure there's a winner. But wrestling learned one other lesson that only some boxing and fighting organizations have since learned, or at least have since embraced. And that is the fact that athletic competitions sell a lot better when there are clearly defined characters and relatable conflicts involved. Muhammad Ali was a great boxer. So was Mike Tyson. But their athleticism alone is not what made them stars. They became characters. They were brash, cocky, and outspoken.
I'm experienced now, professional. Jaw's been broke, been knocked down a couple times. Bad. Been chopping trees. I done something new for this fight. I done wrestled with an alligator. That's right. I have wrestled with an alligator. I done tussled with a whale. I done handcuffed lightning, throw thunder in jail. That's bad. Only last week, I murdered a rock, injured a stone, hospitalized a brick. I'm so mean, I make medicine sick.
I was gonna rip his heart out. I'm the best ever. I'm the most brutal and vicious and most ruthless champion there's ever been. There's no one can stop me. Lynx is a conqueror. No, I'm Alexander. He's no Alexander. I'm the best ever. There's never been anybody as ruthless. I'm Sonny Liston. I'm Jack Dempsey. There's no one like me. I'm from Nairclaw. There's no one that can match me. My style is impetuous. My defense is impregnable. And I'm just ferocious. I want your heart. I want to eat his children. Praise be to Allah.
So people began to watch their fights even if they weren't fans of the sport, either because they admired them and wanted to support them, or because they didn't like them and they wanted to watch them lose. Wrestling was one of the first sports to learn that people would pay to watch somebody lose. And Muhammad Ali actually credited wrestling with being one of the inspirations for his persona.
I saw a wrestler once named Gorgeous George, and the place was jam-packed with people. Cars was lined up for miles. They hated Gorgeous George. They wanted him to beat, but they paid $100 for a ringside seat. So I got this from Gorgeous George. I said, this is a good idea. Look, he's getting rich. So I start talking. I am the greatest.
And we see similar things now in the UFC with guys like Conor McGregor, who presents himself as brash and irreverent. Or John Jones, who's widely considered to be one of the greatest MMA fighters of all time, but who's become a bit of a villain after multiple drug test failures. So, he leans into it. Or even a guy like Floyd Mayweather, who is amongst the highest paid boxers of all time, partially because he marketed himself as a cocky villain.
But it's more like he's an A-level fighter. He's just not in the Mayweather league.
Wrestling sells characters and conflicts. When boxing and UFC follow suit, they do pretty well at the box office too. Some of the top-selling UFC pay-per-views of all time involve Conor McGregor, Nate Diaz, who's become a beloved anti-hero.
Hey, I'm not surprised, motherfucker.
And Brock Lesnar, who is also a villain and a real-life pro wrestler. Top boxing pay-per-views also see characters like Mayweather and Tyson at the top, both of whom were amazing boxers but also notorious villains throughout their career. So the question rises, why do these guys sell so well? Because people love drama. They love heroes, they love villains, they love stories. And that's why characters became such a big part of professional wrestling. Wrestling began manipulating audience engagement by creating characters that were designed to be hated and others that were designed to be loved. They turned the sport into a theater of good versus bad. One of the first popular wrestling characters was a guy named Gorgeous George, who presented himself as an effeminate, haughty pretty boy, and thus inspired audiences of average guys to dislike him, especially during the old days when cross-dressing wasn't accepted as a form of self-expression. He was an anomaly, and he marketed himself as a villain because of it. Furthermore, he was a villain in an age where TV was still new, so gaudy characters like this weren't common. He was seen in a time where people didn't see different too often. To put it into context, imagine you were riding on a train, and a guy dressed like a can of soda got on. What are you gonna do? You're probably going to look away and politely try to stare at him while you're pretending to read your phone. Why? Because it's out of the ordinary. That's the attention that he got too. And he was so good at his character that people loved to hate him. People disliked him so much that they were willing to pay to see him get beat. And he even inspired lots of TV sales as a result. This is a variation of what's commonly known today as hate watching. When people watch something because they enjoy disliking it. But it's not just people's dislike that kept them watching. It was also sensationalism. George was so unique that people wanted to see what he would do next. This phenomenon has since manifested across various media, a notable example being Howard Stern. Howard Stern was the most popular radio host in the US for decades, and he presented himself as a lewd, rebellious truth speaker. He defined the term shock jock, which referred to radio hosts who used sensationalism to appeal to a wide audience. He was very opinionated, which made him a very divisive character, with his audience being comprised of people who enjoyed his persona and those who listened to him because they detested his persona.
The average Stern hater listens for 2.5 hours a day.
Look, but if they hate him, why do they listen?
Most common answer, I want to see what he'll say next.
A more modern example of this could be Donald Trump, who is also a very divisive character, but whom people watch, some because they love him, some because they hate him, but many because they just want to see what shocking thing he'll say next. As people like Donald Trump and Howard Stern would learn later, Gorgeous George learned early that by becoming a character, he could use his persona to his advantage. Thus, Gorgeous George relied on a mix of hate-watching and sensationalism that exists and still works pretty well, even today. The point being, he was so good at being a bad guy that he made anyone who fought him a good guy by default. and that made money. So wrestling became a very black and white sport. It focused on the good versus the evil. Rarely did good guys fight each other or bad guys fight each other. It presented many of its matches as a battle between good and bad because these were very easy concepts to understand, and this engaged the audience more. It made the stories super easy to follow. The audience knew who it was supposed to root for, who it was supposed to boo, and it would follow the script it was given. They'd cheer the good guy, they'd boo the bad guy, and this kept people watching at the time. But wrestling suffers from the same thing news media suffer from, a complete lack of regard for its audience. Even though wrestling started off by trying to appeal to more naive audiences, like people who they could trick into thinking the contests were real, it eventually grew popular enough to enter the mainstream. Vincent McMahon, the most famous wrestling promoter in history, and the man who turned WWE into a billion-dollar company, eventually admitted that wrestling was scripted. After decades of denial, he was the man who came out and acknowledged wrestling was not actually a competitive sport.
Well, you know, wrestling is fake, though, right?
No. Where the hell are you back?
Come on.
What's the matter with you, huh? Wrestling is fake.
Well, you know what I mean. It's
I don't know what you mean.
Well, it's entertainment. It's not real fighting, you know.
Not.
We in the WWF think that you, the audience, are quite frankly tired of having your intelligence insulted. We also think that you're tired of the same old simplistic theory of good guys versus bad guys.
But despite admitting that it was developing more nuance and complexity over the years, 50 years ago, good guy versus bad guy worked. Partially because there was nothing else on TV, and all the storylines were simple and superficial back then. For example, on the sitcom I Love Lucy, one of the most popular TV shows of the early TV era, Lucy and her husband on the show, who happened to be her husband in real life, didn't even share a bed on TV. Because, you know, that'd be suggestive. The characters on the show slept in different beds, despite the fact they were married on the show and in real life. The shows back then wanted to keep things simple. It was G-rated naivety at its best. But that's because it was a simpler time. As far as entertainment is concerned, people have since proven that they can handle more complex storytelling. Look at the popularity of shows over the last few decades. Breaking Bad, Walking Dead, The Wire, Sopranos, Game of Thrones. These are shows with complexity and nuance. Characters are blurred. Some heroes have flaws. Some villains are likable. Some characters walk the line between good and bad because that's more realistic. But for better or worse, wrestling still relies on very simplistic storytelling, much like modern media do. One important distinction being that wrestling appeals to kids, whereas news media are often primarily consumed by adults. Now, professional wrestling orchestrates feuds between two opposing forces, one flawlessly good and the other despicably evil. This is the general formula it follows. The characters are usually flat, the conflicts are usually unsophisticated, and the audience is encouraged on how to behave, who to cheer, who to boo, and when to do it. Despite the fact that wrestling could become more highbrow, it chooses not to. This is exactly what we're seeing in modern media today. The way media presents information also encourages us to align with certain groups. Then, depending on the media we watch, our group is typically presented as the good guys, and any opposing group is presented as the common enemy, or the bad guy. Whether it be a person, or a place, or a thing, or just an idea, this is what modern media present, and then the pro wrestling narrative plays out, in which you and your group are the good guys who are doing the right thing, and those with opposing ideas, they're the bad guys. They're always wrong, and they are deeply, possibly irrevocably, flawed. There is no grayscale. It's very simplistic. This has become our reality. And if you want proof, I'll show you.